the Eurocentrism. You probably you know what is Eurocentrism. Maybe it's not a classic topic, but according to me, it's a good way to understand better what is globalization and what and how globalization born. The books that I have used are what of Samir Amin, Eurocentrism, and an article of André Wunder-Frank that we had. In particular, I used the article of Wunder-Frank for a kind of historical digression, to show you how did the relationship between the Europe and the Asia or the Orient in general changed after the Industrial Revolution and after the 19th century. The book of Amin, instead, has been very useful for the second part of my paper, because Amin made a kind of a deep analysis of what is Eurocentrism and what are the main points that characterize Eurocentrism.
Character.
Okay. But first of all, I spoke about an historical digression. Well, until about 19th century, the relationship, the European opinion of the Orient was very positive. In particular because Asia, for example, China, India, etc., was the center of the world economy. Asia was so much more developed than Europe. We can think, for example, to the fact that Europe was obliged to import a lot of goods from Asia because European countries, were not able to produce from themselves what they need. On the contrary, China, India, and all Asian countries in general can produce what they need and also a lot of commodities, to use a term of Wunder-Frank, commodities that are goods, not primary goods. Goods that, for example, only rich people could buy. But about in the middle of the 19th century, with the Industrial Revolution, something is changed. Changed because there was a big increase of productivity of labor, of producing energy. There were a lot of innovation that permitted to European capitalism to produce so much more than the past. The same thing didn't happen in Asia, where there was a big loss of competitiveness, because Asian countries were not able to answer, to face this big transformation that Europe was leading. So from now on, Europe gained the economic leadership, and from now on, European people created this kind of myth of their superiority, and began to judge in a negative way the Orient and all Asia and all Oriental people. But what is really this Eurocentrism? I mean, individuated two main points. The first is denial of real European origins. Maybe this is a very strong point. In fact, Amin says conclude this first part, saying that Europe has Oriental origins, because we know, we studied in the school, that the European culture began with the ancient Greece, democracy, humanism, rationalism, yes. Was born with the Greece, with Platon, Socrates, and the ancient Greece belongs to Oriental cultures, Phoenicians, Egyptians, etc. So, if ancient Greece belongs to Oriental culture and Europe belongs to ancient Greece, also Europe has Oriental origin. But the contribution of the Orient to the Greece is not considered in a positive way. Is denied. The second point, the second paradigm of Eurocentrism is, according to Amin, a kind of racist interpretation of the Orient. According to Amin, just the distinction between West and East is an European invention to justify and to show who is the best and who is the worst. In fact, we can find example of this kind of ideology also in the European culture. We can think, for example, to Max Weber, that in trying to explain the birth of capitalism, makes a kind of comparison between the modern, rational, and democratic West and the irrational, magic, and underdeveloped Orient. So it's an ideology that didn't remain, unfortunately, only a way of thinking, an ideology, because, for example, about in the last 30 years of the 19th century, we know that European countries decided to conquer other countries, and in particular they went towards Africa, Asia, and the Orient in general, because they considered these countries as inferior. Their justification was to bring civilization also to the inferior people, but we know that they really want to find new lands to populate and new resources to exploit. So the burden of the white man maybe was presented as a sacrifice, but it isn't in this way. The third paragraph of my paper, that is a kind of conclusion, it's a question. Is the Eurocentrism a kind of globalization ancestor? The answer, according to me, is positive, because Eurocentrism, that's to say the opinion that Western culture is the best, is superior, is arrived to our age. Maybe today is better known as the Westernization of the world. Sylvia this morning speaks about Coca-Colonization, for example. It's one of the aspects of the Westernization of the world. In the question of, in the issue of the poverty in the world and the problem, the aim of solving this poverty, the proposal that globalization and the supporters of globalization say is do as we do, belong to our model of development. But we know that this is... There isn't only one way of development, and this proposal, speaks of a kind of a process of delinking of the third world, of the south of the world. Elitist in the sense that these people, the poor countries, etc., have to search for another way of development, because there are differences among the different people of the world, from a natural, political, social, and also economic point of view. So it's impossible to think that everybody has to do the same thing. And also because from an ecological point of view, this is impossible, because the resources of the planet are finishing. So if, for example, China, the case of China, if 2 billion, other 2 billion of people will do as we do, we in the next years, we will have a lot of problems.